Shalom and welcome. Greetings, I'm Alonso, and we will continue on the establishing the houses of Israel in our yearly and daily calendar cycle graph, you know, in their proper place. Now, we've been able to go over Simon, Reuben, Judah, Zebulun, and Issachar. We are going to continue with Dan, but let I make mention that already there have been a few graphs uploaded, posted on the Facebook pages, the Line of Judah Society and Rastafari Fellowship. Go ahead and check those out if willing, and care not for little, you know, because they're not made perfect, you know, like the worldly kind of graphs, but I don't seek that. As long as the information is there, you know, if ones want to make it look like I don't know, something like they would teach in graphic design. I don't really know what that is, but I'm assuming it has to do with graphs. And so, you know, like if some can do a better job, I mean, by all means, go ahead and feel free to do so. It would be helpful. So as for I, as long as the information is there, you know, but they will improve. You know, these are the beginning stages of what I hope will be, will be observed and kept and recognized by all faithful Rastafari for its obvious contributions to our liberty. Excuse me. So let us continue on with Dan and open up your Bible scriptures to the book of Genesis for chapter 49. And you know, this is regarding the blessings that Jacob, Israel in this case, gave to his children. And we're going to start with verse 16, and it's going to read, Dan shall judge his people. So Dan will judge his people. Shall judge. Okay, my bad. Let I try that again. Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Now, the common mistake I've noticed throughout the world, even the Ashkenazi and Sephardi convert Jews, as well as some Hebrew Israelites, and, you know, many throughout the world believe that Dan is, in fact, the scales, which would be, in this case, Issachar, correctly and rightfully so. Judge, and I'm assuming that they make this common mistake because of the word judge. Judge does not necessarily mean a weighing of balance, you know. You could, even Jesus Christus says, judge not according to appearance, but rather make a righteous judgment. That means you can make a wrong judgment. And so, judgment does not mean the balance, you know. And so, although this is significant of the judgment period throughout the year, right? But continuing, I is going to go on further and explain why Dan has been located in this space time in which it is now found. And so let us continue on by reading verse 17, and it reads, Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse heels, so that his rider falleth backward. And so with that being said, let I make mention that not only Issachar is an ass's colt or a donkey, but also God is riding upon a horse, and we'll go into that a little in time. So Dan is a serpent. Serpent and reptiles, you know, oftentimes they are representative of the same species. And I say this because the worldly point of view sees this time and space as scorpion. You know, the constellation of scorpion and the backbiter or something like that. Well, in this case, it would be similar. Now, let us remember, you know, since Genesis, that, you know, the serpent shall be biting the heel of the horse, and or the heels, rather, and I shall be bruising the head, right? So, now that we've mentioned that, let us recall that if Dan is a serpent along the path, and this graph is representative of the path of the sun. And so let us let us state that that in this case the rider, the one riding the path, is the sun. So now the sun you know, like Issachar, the ass, you know, carrying the sun on him, because this is sunset, so the sun is setting on Issachar. Now Don, being a serpent, biting the heels of Issachar, now Issachar crouches down, and the sun falleth, you know, the rider in this case falleth backward. And this is, this area right here is in fact autumn, which is also known as fall, the fall of the rider upon the horse, because of Don, the serpent, biting the heels of the horse and the rider falling backward. So, you know, for obvious reasons, I and I have rightfully located Don in this time and space, and not the common idea that it's the weighing of the weighing of measures, you know. So let us continue by reading verse 18. I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. And this is going to be even further evidence of how this is right judgment, locating Dan in its proper time space, you know, in the path of the sun. But we have to go and explain God, you know, to deal with the verse, I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. So let us continue on with God. And we shall begin with verse 19. God, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at last. Now that's all the information we get regarding God. And at first it seems, well, at first it seems quite difficult. But let us make mention that the worldly view sees this as Sagittarius, a horse, half male, I guess, with a bow and arrow. Well, you know, if you check out the graph that I and I have posted or uploaded on the Facebook pages, you'll notice that it's only a man on the horse. It doesn't, you know, we don't have to get into all this this childish, that half man, half horse. This could even be reflective of how, oh, okay, here you go. You know, give thanks for this which I just received. If you recall, you know, the Egyptians, the story where they were invaded by the Hyksos, and the Egyptians had not known or seen horses and chariots. Well, this is Egypt. This is heaven up here. You know, this is the path of the sun. You know, I'm quickening the spirit, quickening matter. You know, I'm growing the growth. You know, and well, the bearing of fruit and such details as that. This is I don't want to say hell, but if anything, this would be how the colder seasons. You know, but this is reflective of the Red Sea. You know, and also Egypt. The coming out of Egypt, passing over to promises, you know. So, and the whole Red Sea deal is not only because these are lower frequencies, but also because the sunlight is lower, and it's not as bright as up here. And green would be up here because of the obvious growth and, you know, the flowering and blossom of and giving up fruit. And this will all be explained biblically. So okay, let us continue on with God. So God is a troop. I just wanted to make mention that the horse deal, because Don, you know, biteth either horse's heels, you know. It could be, I don't have evidence for that, but you know, it's a good location for Don. So, and it is the proper location for Don, and as well God. Now God at first seemed difficult, so a troop shall overcome him, at last he shall overcome. So maybe he's been overcome by Don, but now he shall overcome. Let me Let we continue on to mention that some definitions in the Blue Letter Bible, some Hebraic origins of the word God, are troops. So troops, like a military force, like an army, a gathering, even. This is knowing that this is the gathering season. Now continuing, has come to me. Cut, invade, prune. So some other definitions then are to cut and to prune. Very well, this could be considered the pruning season or the cutting, you know, and because you're invading these trees and you're cutting, you're not, you know, you're overcoming, you're cutting that which is not needed, circumcising even. But let us continue. More of the information to sustain this location of the house of God, the tribe of God in this time space, is found none other than in the New Testament. So let us go to the book of Mark. To the book of Mark, and we shall be dealing with, or rather, we shall be learning from chapter 11. Chapter 11, and we shall begin with So let me just summarize a little bit before we go into the actual verses. Or let us begin with verse 7 rather. And they brought the colt of Jesus, Yeshua even, and cast their garments on him, and he sat upon him. Now, this is right after Jesus sent them out of, I believe it's Jerusalem, and said, go to Bethpage, and you know, there shall be an ass's colt which no man have ever ridden, you know, and bring them. And so, once again, the horse, the ass's colt being mentioned again, on which never man have been on. Continuing with verse 8, and many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. Now, I forgot to make mention that this is the Red Sea, the Sea of Reeds, because of all the cutting down, not only the red, right, but the cutting down of the branches, as just mentioned. So, the horse is being mentioned, the bringing of the horse, and now the everyone's cutting branches and putting them along the way. Continuing. Well, let us read that again. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. Let I also make mention that the cutting of circumcision, it's probably, maybe it has to do with this, because everyone, you know, their garments. And so all those dirty garments are you know, cutting off that flesh, you know, those fleshy garments. Not that this is an interpretation for this, but I'm just using that to give an idea of you know, the pruning that's going on, that's taking place. So let us continue by mentioning, and they that went before and they that followed cried, saying, Hosanna, salvation, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. You see, so those that go before and those that go after, Don mentioned, let us go to there, because I kind of forgot what it said, but it said that I have waited for thy salvation. Correctly, it says, I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. So once again, more evidence for this judgment of locating Don in in its proper location in time space. So those and also the fact that it's mentioning that many are gathering and laying down the branches that they cut from the trees as straw. Not only is it significant of the pruning, the circumcision, but we're also noticing a gathering of armies, of troops. God shall be a troop, and also invading, because they go to Jerusalem, then they come out of Jerusalem, then they go into Jerusalem again, and then Jesus Christos sends two to go and find an ass's colt at in which never man had sat in Bethage or Bethpage, and then they come back and they're invading. The invasion, you know, the overcoming and the being overcome is being I guess kind of like symbolized or actually lived out, you know, and that which was concealed to now revealed, you know, in New Testament. So continuing, and Jesus entered into Jerusalem, see the invasion, and into the temple, and when he had looked round about upon all things, and now the eventide was come. The eventide. I had to make some research on that. I've not yet done that, but so let us continue. But I point that out because I sense it that it is of interest. He went out to Bethany with the 12. So now he's coming out. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came. So the fact that he saw a fig tree and he went to it, it's because it had leaves. So it must have been like, you know, it must have been around this time when the fall, when the leaves fall. So seeing a fig tree with leaves must have been like, if you know, none others, because there must have been more than one, you know. So the rest probably had no leaves. And Jesus made the assumption, and this isn't an assumption, this is an interpretation, right? But you know, I pray it's not the wrong one, you know, for I sake, but and for all I and I's sake, that we don't be misled. So if any know that, if any feel that I should be stood corrected, feel free to do so. It would be so, it would be beneficial for all and I. And so continuing, Jesus Christ must have assumed, well, you know, it's the fall and that fig tree has leaves. I'm gonna go check it out. I'm kind of hungry. Continuing, kind of lost my place. He came, if happily he might find anything thereon. You see, he's hungry, and he's all like, well, there's a fig tree with leaves. So it's even expressing how he approached it happily, hoping to find some fruit, you know. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. That's another clue. I don't know when figs, you know, bear fruit and stuff like that, or give leaves, but and I was supposed to research that. I still haven't. But nonetheless, you know, it's backing up the judgment of that I and I have made according to the positioning, establishing of the house of God, you know, in this cycle or graph, pictograph. So let us continue. And Jesus answered and said to it, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. This is also like the drying season, you know, because he's about to dry it from the root. So, or maybe even declaring that no longer will fig trees bear fruit around this time, you know. You know, him having authority over all things. Why not? And So now he enters Jerusalem into the temple, and there is a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of sin going on, you know, making the house of I and thy father like a. Okay, let I just read that. And they come to Jerusalem, and Jesus went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and would not suffer that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. And he taught, saying to them, Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. So now the scribes and the chief priests heard it, and sought how they might destroy him, for they feared him, because all the people was astonished at his doctrine. And when even was come, he went out of the city, and in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, said to him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withereth away. And Jesus answering said to them, Have faith in God. For verily I say to you, that whosoever shall lay to this mountain, whosoever shall say to this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he said shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he said. You know, I apologize for not reading that all that great, but I'm thinking something else, but you know, let us pause right there. Believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. You know, I just have to mention that. And when ye stand praying, forgive, if ye have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if ye do not forgive, neither your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Excuse that. You know, I don't know what's going on, but nonetheless, I need to make mention that, let's see if I can recall most of this. They're coming out of, you know, this is describing the coming out. And anyways, you know, let me first describe the arrows and the bow. Well, the bow is set up in heaven, and the arrows are ours. You know, I guess strings of love of of Yehoshua. But man, I'm kind of losing focus. Give I just 1 second to recover. Okay, let's continue. So they're passing to this side. This is beginning winter, and you know, when they come out, you know, they notice that the fig tree has been, you know, dried from the root, and this is a dry season, I guess we could say. But you know, more important than that, as far as, you know, building a case for the locations that I and I have set for each of the houses, it's interesting how Peter, calling to remembrance, said to him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withereth away. So now the winds are blowing the leaves, you know, the winter, the withering of the fig tree. And also remember the Shabbat. We're entering the Sabbath. We're entering the Sabbath and the remembrance, because Manasseh is forgetfulness. You know, the cloudy season, even we could say, because the clouds, the forgetfulness is getting ready for the rains. And so the, you know, remember says, you know, well, Peter the rock brings to remembrance. And then this is also the goat, the mountain goat, and I wanted to represent it, and it is represented as the mountain goat, which the world sees as half something, half another thing. But you know, I just chose the mountain goat. And remember the scapegoat, you know, the forgiving of one, and one for Jah, and one for, you know, one being set free and one being kept. And this is also the branches, one shall dry up, you know, but one shall be double fruitful. So Ephraim up here, and then Manasseh down here, you know, the both shall cross the wall, says, according to the blessing of Joseph, that his sons shall, his branches shall cross the wall, and cursed, oh, see, it's all coming, you know, it's all making perfect sense, and I give thanks. Just in the nick of time, you know, Joseph received the blessing of the bow in the sky of heaven, and the curse, you know, of the underworld, we could say even. So the blessing of heaven and the curse, and you know, Jesus Christos cursed the fig tree. So this is the cursing of the branches, and this would be the blessing, you know, the curses and the blessings is also reflective. And then the fact that the scripture goes on to make mention the forgiving, forgive, forgetfulness. You know, this is the time to be forgiving. Well, it's always the time to be forgiving, but you know, the representation of the house of Manasseh is this area right here, the beginning of winter. Let me just mention that Nachseye, or maybe that has to do with Nahase, but I seem to be in a state of kind of like of seeking more information regarding why Nahase is considered August. So, but you know, evidence in scripture leads to Manasseh rightfully being located in this time space, you know, along the path of the sun. So I believe with that we can continue. Well, it says also cause to forget, to desert, to neglect. Nonetheless, I believe we can proceed and feel somewhat comfortable with this positioning of Manasseh. Now let us move on to Benjamin, Ben-Yami. Now let us first recall Bane. Bane is, you know, in the Ethiopic is like a corpse. This would be the valley more correctly. Around here, the valley sense, the womb, the hollow. But also like in the sense of a belly. The belly of the whale, even, we could say. This is Aquarius, the pouring out of the water, you know, but this is Ben-Yamin, the son of the right hand. And I also have to make mention that right is east. Right, the son of God, the right, Judah, God himself even. The son, the left, the left son, or the left side, the west, the westening, or the westerning. You know, the corpse, the dying the fading away, the withering, even the withering of the stars, even when they come down in the west, in the westerning, as the Egypt's called, you know, life in the east, westerning, and you know, eventually disappearing on this side. So that is interesting in itself, but Benjamin, the son of my sorrows. So, the son of my sorrows, the complete opposite of the joy of Judah. You see? And the son of my sorrows, you know, the crying, the rainy season even, the clouds being the forgetfulness being established here, the neglecting, and then the raining, the sorrows, the tears, because Ben Omni, because she died, you know, giving labor, the womb, the corpse, you know, see how it all ties into it. We could stay here forever. Unfortunately, I'm not that knowledgeable in scripture to continue, but if, you know, Jesus Christus himself could, you know, spend lifetimes here, you know, just declaring the perfection of Jah creation, you know. But let that suffice, Sinai, for now. But also making mention that the switching, Manasseh was born first, but then Joseph switched the hands, and he got the lower hand, we could say, and Ephraim got the right hand, and you know, just more evidence to you know, that, you know, Jah will, I mean, give thanks that this worked out, you know, even better than I thought. But yeah, you know, just building the case, because this must be, this is really important, you know. We must really build a foundation for this in order for it to stand the test of times, you know. So, let us continue by going over some, some information regarding Benjamin. Now, okay, I forgot to mention that, you know, how Jesus began overturning the money tables and all that. This is because this time this is 12 p.m. This is Satan's area, or Saturn's. This is being ruled by Saturn, the opposite force of Judah. And so this is like the dark times. But it's also a good time. It doesn't have to be, you know, David always gets up in the middle of the night. You know, a lot of good can come from this, but a lot of people go crazy around these times. And the fact that Jesus entered this area of overturning and judging, also, okay, let I just add, I guess it's coming to add, but it's important that the law has to have, the balance has to have an officer, a judge, a troop, the enforcement. So this is actually like even being visible, being it's revealing the passing judgment, you know, of judgment passing on the wicked them. And this is, you know, Christmas, you know how evil it gets, you know. Back in the day, they used to have the biggest, most satanic orgies in the world, and this is what is kind of like corpse, you know, in this case right here, in the Son of Sorrows, the tears of the lamenting of all this sorrow and all this and all this evil ways going on in darkness when the sun is shining the least. And so, you know, just continuing with that, Benjamin, like, shall be as a like a raven, as a wolf, you know, I guess, a dance, the dance of the wolf, even, you could say, the dance of the rain, the rain dance. In the morning he shall devour the prey, at night shall divide the spoil. So at night they do all their, their raving, you know. In the morning he shall devour the prey. You know, we're entering to the morning. And even the morning, you know, one cries in morning. And the sun rises in the morning. You see, so, you know, I give thanks because this is turning out just good. Good for now. And, you know, if any out there want to make some suggestions and stuff like that, do so, you know, go ahead and do so. It'd be greatly appreciated. Now, Let I continue. Also, let me make mention that James and John, the sons of Zebedee, might have something to do with this, with Ephraim and Manasseh, or something, because they're mentioned in this section. But I guess that was not necessary. Okay, good that I went over that, because the temple at Jerusalem at check this out. Okay, so there's thieves in the night. There's thieves at the temple of Jerusalem here, making it a place of thievery when it should be a house of prayer. You know, of asking for forgiveness, even for Jah to forget our wrongdoings, you know, our shortcomings. Now, I make mention of that because thieves, the city, or the capital of thieves at one point, kind of, it comes to mind. And also Morea, one of the biblical locations. I read in some information that the capital of Ethiopia at one point was Morea or something like that, Morie, and that's interesting because it's that city is overtaken by Egypt during the whole Thutmose and stuff like that, and the capital of Ethiopia descends or actually elevates further south. Just pointing that out. But the thieves is because you know, all this wrongdoing come out, they do their things in the night, right? And if you're not waiting for it, you wake up in the morning and you don't know what happened, you know? But if you're waiting for it, he cometh like a thief in the night. And so, not to get into detail on that or context, but the main idea was the pouring out of the vessels. This is the pouring out of the vessels, you know, the forgetting of the old man and entering not yet the new, but the beginning of the new, you know, the end, because this is already like new rain, new water filling up vessels, and this is the pouring out, because Jesus Christos, he entered the temple and began pouring out all vessels, and eventually, you know, it's not a shame, because you drink your water and you know it's all gone, but that's your vessel made room for a new substance, for clean water, new water, rain water. And also that reminds that one of the examples I gave to Ayman Fleshy sister's boyfriend was that if he was born in a place of depression, that he knew it was a valley. I said, I and I live in the valley, Imperial Valley in California. It's the lowest place. Now, it's not a curse necessarily as it has been described previously, but look at it this way. If California were in a, well, you know, we are in a drought, but let's pretend, let's make believe that the United States, the people actually knew that we were in the situation. You know, God forbid that they do, right? You know, I'm being sarcastic. Let's not have to be that way, you know. But so let I go forward on correcting that mistake of using sarcasm. But yeah, you know, we're obviously in a drought, but no one seems to know or care. Like if it didn't even matter, because I don't know, because their iPods are, you know, they've uploaded some kind of new program or something. Anyways, I don't really know much about that, but continuing with the advice that I gave this individual was that a depression could be the best thing, because you know, let's say that Jah be super merciful, which he is, and it began raining. The valley, the depth, this valley, this so-called depression, would be the salvation, because once it's empty, it makes room for the preservation of new and for salvation, for new possibilities, even for the filling up of good and the pouring out of evil, then the filling up of good. You see, so a depression can be salvation, you know, and I can testify, my personal experience, that's exactly what it was. I may not have known any other truth that was true and pure and sincere, but I knew that the depression I was in, the pain, you know, I knew that was true. That, you know, maybe that was I'm on calling, you know, because I finally, like, came across something real, something true, you know, like, waking I up from all this illusion. At least, I could say that the pain was real, and that I did not want anything to do with this world. And so, you know, if that was the only thing that was pure in my heart enough to you know, get a wake-up call, you know, from the man upstairs, you know, Yehoshua HaMashiach being the authority, him being the reason for the Spirit, the gift of the Spirit, and, you know, the Father, you know, Kedamawi Haile Selassie, in the whole Trinity, if that was enough to get the Trinity to, you know, to awake Iman, then so be it. But yeah, so that's kind of like the whole situation. This does not have to be a curse. Let it be a curse to them that curse themselves, but let it be just another step along the way of Jah path, you know, for I and I overcomers. I and I is not to stumble across this. I and I is just to kind of like just leap it, you know. It's like them depressions, you know. Actually, I need a depression. I got no more room and I'm on fridge, you know, and so you fill it up. So yeah, that's let us continue before we kind of phase off. So now let us deal with Naphtali, and we shall return to the book of Genesis, verses chapter 49. I'd like to give thanks to everyone, you know, like sincerely and honestly, everyone that's been participating, you know, it really means a lot, you know, and I give thanks to everyone, and remind everyone that Jah willing, this is just a gateway to higher knowledge with Wendem Yadon himself, you know, and keep that in mind, you know. We are one in the body of Christ, and I say this just to say it, but yeah, I give thanks to everyone. You know, everyone responded, well, not everyone, right, but I'm sure those that could and were able, there was just a positive response, you know, from some of the messages, and so I give thanks to everyone, you know, like, I have no power in myself, you know, whatever I do, it's all you, and I can't stress upon that, because I don't exist without the rest of the members of Christ, you know, and that's a truth. I speak of a truth when I say that, because if the eyes are not there to testify of my existence, I do not exist, you know. We only exist in one Jesus Christos, even Kedamawi Haile Selassie, you know, I and I Father in the Spirit, you know, and that is a truth. So I give thanks, you know, everything that appeared to have been initiated by Iman is not so. It's just as much every one of you that even does as much as just take the time to watch what has been presented, and those that participate and so on and so forth. It's just as much you making this possible than it is I and I, and I and I and I, you know? So, and that just came out. So let it be known to the world. So, okay, so we were on our way to Genesis chapter 49, verses 21. Naphtali is a hind let loose. He giveth goodly words. That's all we got for Naphtali. That's unfortunate, because, but maybe it's not. Okay, let us continue. Naphtali, a hind let loose. This would be like the feet, the two, you know how the world describes it as two fishes? That's actually the what I and I put in the graph. But nonetheless, it's the 2 feet. So the raining leads to the washing of the feet, leads to the passing over in the authority of the Ras, of the Rosh, even the head, you know. But Naphtali, the hind, the back legs, the let loose, the feet being untied, and, you know, and walking. So, but even more than that would be, Naphtali is the wrestling. And deceitfulness is actually included. But, so the washing of deceitfulness, you know, the washing of the feet. And also twist and like the twine, and to twine, to enter the wrestling, you know, because the washing of feet, I guess, will get us to the ras, to the head. So the wrestling with oneself, you know, and I don't really have all that much, you know, on this, but nonetheless, we shall continue to build on this. Okay, we're going to have to go on forward in to to Benjamin a little bit again. And Naphtali, it has to do, this is forgetfulness, forgiving, and this is, I guess, death, and this is deceiving. You see how the twisting, the wicked, the sorrow, the pain, the crying, the rains, the clouds, the dimness, the darkness. So, and this is the West. And this is Egypt. And this is the United States, we could even say. The United States of the West. You know? So, continuing with that, I mentioned that because this is, I can't get away from the idea that this is the Sabbath. Separate thyself. Let this be a crown to the head. If we separate ourselves when all the wickedness of the world is multiplied, then I and I shall truly be holy, I and I would say. You know? A lot of stuff go down around this time. If I and I are to keep the temple a house of prayer, you know, are to be reborn, be washed with the rains, with the new waters, be washed of our sins and shortfallings, and we shall overcome. We shall pass over. You know, this is perfect. It's, you know, I'm beginning to understand that this is, I knew it was important, but it's just being revealed how what importance means. Benjamin is the opposite of Judah also. This is water. This is fire. Judgment. One shall be baptized with water. But Jah Almighty shall baptize I and I with fire, you know. So even that, you know, the opposite ends, polar ends, and so the whole Satan and God philosophy, but that's not the case. We know it's all Jah. You know, no room for Satan here, except room for the Sabbath, you know, give time of rest. You know, Jah light, you know, is not that it's resting, it's that I and I is to be Jah light and lighting up, you know, lighting up all this dimness and you know, going forth. But it's a time of rest, you know, the darkness, time of sleep, time of, you know, it's all perfectly described in winter. So let us proceed. We've done a little bit of information on, or case building on, building on the rock, actually, on Asher, Simon, Ephraim. We did not cover Ephraim. Ephraim is kind of obvious for the fact that Ephraim is to be double fruitful. You know, this is a spring growth, and eventually it reaches like the peaks, and it has to do with, this is gathering, right? So this is double fruitful. Oh, okay, here we go. Watch, here's something interesting. Here in the valley, in the so-called depression, there's like two in summer, when they work with grass, or the alfalfa, Bermuda hay, and all that, there's two harvests, actually. So double fruitfulness, you know, this is, you know, they cut the fields once, and then they grow again, because the sun is so strong, and it's quickening the spirit of matter, that it grows again, and there's even time for a second harvest. In some cases, there might even be an extra harvest, you know, I only know. But as for I know that this is to be the blessing in heaven, the blessing in the promised land, the double fruitfulness, Ephraim, the whole switching of hands, you know. And let us see if there's, because let us double check that there's other information regarding Ephraim. And I may have not been careful enough to do more research on Ephraim, but and the doubleness, it has to do with the twins. This is the hands on Iodide grass. We have the hands of Kedamawi Haile Selassie, and the hands, you know, the twin shoulders, the twin arms, the twin, you know, twin everything. And this is interesting, because if you go into the Book of Mark, kind of goes through this like in order, and it's just in time, you know, Jah willing, will go through that. You know, it's so interesting. It's let I give all like an example of what I mean. There's the baptism of John, and then there's the Passover, and then the light of the world, and then there's the speak, I believe, sermons. I'm not too sure about that one, excuse that, but like I said, this isn't because I already prepared something for that, it's to give an idea. And then in around this time, there seems to be a lot of twos going on, a lot of doubles, double patterns. And then it skipped over to this, and this is where there's a female child, 12 years of age, and then there's that she had died or was dying, and you know, Jesus Christ will make her rise, like the sun rise. But and then it's also in the same chapters that the lady that had been, you know, had an issue of blood for 12 years, touches the garment. So this is also reflective of the bloody garment of as mentioned before, the bloody garments of the Lion of Judah. And also, well, the double, it's also even reflective of the doubleness, you know. One lady is, for 12 years, has been, had an issue of blood, and then the little girl, 12 years old, was dying. And so this is the moon is ruler of this time space. Well, you know, we know Judah, the sun ruled the whole time space, but you know, the moon is attributed with this time space. And so the whole blood, and the whole even fertility, and the mating season, even the whole doubles sequence, and the garments being, you know, bloody and cleansed with wine, even all of this, you know, all this. So, and let I mention that, you know, how I and I had reviewed on how In this case, 120 days, then the spirit of Jah is not with us. Well, it is still with us, but it's transfiguring. You see, it's the this is the time of the transfiguration, because they couldn't see the face of Jesus Christus because the sun was so bright, you know. Okay, let I go on forward correcting that. It's not to say that this, okay, it's not to make any misinterpretations. What I meant was that in this case, the constellation of Judah, of the line of Judah, is not visible really because the sun is there. So it doesn't mean that Judah had gone elsewhere or died. It just means that the sun covering the constellation of Judah is only symbological of the actual revelation of Jesus Christus himself transfiguring. Let us not confuse that. You know, Jesus Christus is the truth. All these patterns were just how, since the beginning, you know, the creator that is good intended I and I to know all this, to have Jesus Christus since the beginning. But some would think that because this is before, well, nothing is before Jesus Christus, but those fleshy people would assume that, you know, those that have not received the Spirit would assume that because the manifestation of Jesus Christus came after the whole pattern of the cycle of the sun and all that, they would assume that the sun is the actual, like, what is to be worshipped and stuff like that. That's not the case. The fact that we as humans commit sins and errors and fell short of the glory of His Majesty even resulted in what is this, the forgiveness, having to send His only begotten Son to save us, because we obviously were not getting, you know, getting it on our own. And so that's that right there. It's not to say that all of this physical physical symbology is in fact the source, when in reality it's Jesus Christus since the beginning. You know, it's us not understanding Jesus Christus that leads some to believe that, well, it's, you know, that we are to worship the sun, and that because the sun was there first, you know, forget that, you know. And I shouldn't even waste it, I and I time going over such matters, but the fact that I made the mistake of saying that the sun covered Jesus Christo's face, you know, that was wrong of I, and I apologize for that. But it wasn't to mislead any. I mixed up symbolic, or you know, types. I mixed up the symbology with the reality. The sun and the constellation being just an interpretation, a symbolic word picture, of even a so-called image of a shadow of the truth in Jesus Christ. So with that, I can say that I have completed. I give thanks. So I give thanks for everyone that participated, everyone that took their time to be a part of this education. And let I assure everyone that I learned just as much as any out there, you know. And I'm being honest. I didn't know it was gonna come out this positively. I guess it was good. It was good. I just know it was good. So give thanks. Shalom. Let Jah be the guidance and protection of all and I, and let I and I shine. Okay, one last little note, the shining. You know, no one lights a candle and put it underneath the bed. You know, you shine the room with it. So, you know, Jah's made some revelations, you know, and I had kept them aside. But you know, after actually sharing them with my fleshy sister's boyfriend, and I even said to him the same words I said now, you know, no one lighted the candle. I told him that I and thy brother Yehoshua HaMashiach made mention that no one lighted the candle and put it underneath the bed. They shine the light in darkness. And so him being the depression, not that he was in a depression, he's actually quite positive and so-called spiritual, but without Christ, no one who can be serious, you know? So, I mentioned this because I showed him some images, some pictures, and I told him so that thou mayest believe, you know? And I said, not that you're gonna believe, or that I'm thinking that this is gonna make you believe, or I want to make you believe. No, but you know, if your spirit's in the right place, this'll kind of like, this'll enforce anything that I said, because of obvious circumstances. And some, like, no one knows, some know. I've contacted some, and some are aware of some of these pictures, but they're going to be posted because Jah light must be shown. Now, I'm not saying that I see things and that don't misinterpret that, you know. It's just that I've taken pictures of light, and there's a lot more in them than one would see, you know. Some actually do see it, and that is another truth. But I make this mention because I want everyone to know that there's going to be posted some pictures. Don't think that anyone messed with them. I don't even possess the technological ability to even send a message like in 5 minutes. It takes me forever, so much less to organize pictures. So just take a look at them if ones are willing, but don't. I warn ones because I don't want people to think that this is some kind of hoax or some kind of game, and also that to reinforce the fact that this is not to worship stars and stuff like that, you know. Little by little, I've been receiving information that up until this point, I can only say that what has been manifested in the pictures is similar to some information, some of the latest information out there, according to, well, regarding the seeing the world as electric and magnetic forces, you know, seeing the world as electrical, and it is, you know, but everyone makes the mistake of not accepting the true source, Jah Rastafari. So let that be known. Let that not be forgotten. Let us not forget. I have not forgotten, and I pray that no one of the members ever forget. You know, all this, it's building up to something, to a bigger picture. You know, so I just have to say that, you know, because some, you know, unfortunately, some might see some pictures and be like, oh, look, just might, you know, I don't even, because I'm not in that mindset. I don't even know what they could think, but I know for sure that foolish people, not that well grounded, can turn this into something that's not, you know. So everything is Jah, so let us stay in Jah, let Jah guide and protect, you know. And you know, I don't know when they're gonna be posted, but oh yeah, and once they are, if any out there like are interested in the pictures, because some have been cut to like to kind of like just focus on the main. On the important, I guess, like portion of the picture. So if any like want to take a look at them personally and stuff like that, well, I know we're all scattered, right? But I could send via email, I could send anyone willing the actual pictures, and there's a lot of pictures, you know. There's a lot to choose from, so they're not all going to be uploaded, but have that in mind, you know. Just feel free to contact I. This is Jah Light, and let it be. It's just as much yours as it is I and I's, so know that for a fact. Don't think twice to let I know. Can I have this picture and that picture? All it takes for I is to write down your email and put like paper clip or something like that to add as a something. So yeah, let I not take up much more of your time. I give thanks. Shall guide and protect all and I, Rastafari.